I'm Virginia Eskin. Maurice Ravel's piano music feels so good under my hands, and it's very satisfying to play. Listening to it is a treat as well. Let's focus on Ravel today on A Note to You. After all these years of playing Ravel's music, I never realized how tiny he was. He was a really small man. And it sort of shows up in the house he lived in eventually. It was all created almost like a dollhouse. And I always imagined he was sort of large and fleshy, but it turns out not at all. He was very compact, elegant, and not super friendly with other musicians. And the thing that seems to always bop up in the history pages is the fact that he was always compared to Debussy, and he sure didn't like that. He didn't appreciate that Debussy was older and had already started to really strike out with Impressionism, and the two men's music is really very different. The language is the same, atonality and beautiful plummy chords, ninths and sevenths and all kinds of beautiful keys like D-flat and B-flat, G-flat, but Ravel is very different. So if we put him in the time bracket of the latter part of the 19th century, he's born in 1875, he's got a foot sort of in realism, and he's got a foot in what's going to be real Impressionism. He comes from a Basque background. His father was an engineer working on the railroad, which took some time to build, going down from Paris down to into Spain. And I know from traveling on the railroad that the train tracks change. And I don't know whether his father had a hand in that, but at the frontier, that's a way of controlling who's coming into Spain from France. And so they lived there for quite a long time. They weren't living up near Paris. And that was sort of unusual. And his mother was Spanish. And when he was a little boy, she would sing to him in the Basque dialect. So he grows up with a real intimacy and a love of the Spanish chordal structure, and the kind of is a mournful quality to his music that I keep running into. And there are other patterns too as well. There's a sort of spiciness and a lot of repeated notes and things that we've noticed from Spanish music. So that overlays, and that immediately differentiates him from Debussy. And we're going to lead off with what is a very easy sort of Ravel piece, and it's early on. It's written in 1903. He's about 26 years old, and it's a gentle piece, although in the other movements, you will run into that thing that I will be pointing out, all that sort of cross accents, which I take to be sort of the Spanish influence, and he loves dryness. In French, it's called sec. You know, if you order an aperitif and you want it to be very dry, you say très sec. So here's the first movement of Ravel's string quartet in F.
Thank you.
Wasn't that gentle? It's called Moderato, très doux, meaning very sweet. It was the first movement of Ravel's F major string quartet, written in about 1903. Oh, by the way, it was played by the Alban Berg Quartet. And I love the way the theme began, this typical sort of impressionistic way of going. It comes up very matter-of-factly, just a F major scale, and then it sort of blows apart almost like a milkweed pod. It just sort of sprays out all of its beautiful color. And a lot of the times he also spreads the melody, and he did that in that movement. Doesn't that sound Spanish or Basque? It has that sort of mournful quality. And then he throws in lots of atonality. But it's like a toothache. You sort of, it starts to ache and then he gets away from the pain. So he's got lots of pedal, atonal notes, scales going up and down to sort of give some order to the framework. And then overall, there's a nice puffy kind of gentleness to the sound. And that's what it takes to make impressionistic music. Now, our next selection is very Spanish. It's called Alborada del Gracioso. And it means, literally, the Spanish summer morning song or the sort of opening up of the day. I prefer that definition. And he uses a lot of glissandi. And those work very well on stringed instruments. It just means, literally, to take your finger the way you would on a harp. And you go, you know, across the strings. I just did that on the piano. But if you do it on the keys, you get, or on the black notes, it's even prettier. And if you do it real fast, sounds very Spanish. And this piece, you'll hear, there's a lot of glissandi in it. And the orchestra can do it with a real snap, crackle, pop. So let's listen to Alborada del Gracioso by Ravel. Alborada del Gracioso by Maurice Ravel, played by the Montreal Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Charles Dutoit. And I just love Ravel's music. And the more I listen to it, I know why, because it has a mixture of salt and pepper, all those repeated notes. Did you hear those? And he sure loves to put those in. And so often he would compose a piece for piano, and then he would later realize this is good, and then he would orchestrate it. And some of the things that work well with an orchestra do not work well on the piano, and vice versa. But when it comes to making things snap and sort of pop along, Ravel, I think, really is a master at it. So we've got Ravel composing, and we're going to take music really from the glory years of his life. And the picture that I sort of get of his personality is that he was friendly. He's small. He's incredibly elegant and very dapper. And in all the pictures, he wears spats and extremely well turned out and a very stylish man. And when he turned his hand to waltzes, and of course, one of his most famous pieces is La Valse. But the waltzes I want you to hear are the ones that are called noble and sentimental. Valse noble et sentimentale. And first he wrote them for the piano. I'm going to play a piano one, and then we're going to listen to the orchestrated one. And I want you to be aware of what he's doing here. It's incredibly sardonic. I don't know how he gets away with it, because if you listen to the chords, they're really ugly. Or. Again, that sort of toothache quality that he loves to intersperse. But then, just when you think you can't stand it, it moves away and becomes really just like chinchilla fur, so silky. Here's the first one, and it's called Moder. I love to play that. I'm not sure you could waltz to it. So that's the first one for piano, and then here's his version for orchestra. Now here's the fourth one in the Valse Noble. Mm-hmm. here's the orchestral one. Now, this is the last of these little comparisons. This is the sixth waltz in Ravel's set. Here's the orchestral version of it. So those were just some little comparisons so that you could hear how Ravel imitated himself. First he did the piano version, and then it seemed a good idea, so he orchestrated it. And the orchestra you heard there was the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra. Jesus Lopez Cobos was the conductor, and I was playing the piano parts. I loved the way he put one of those glissandos I was speaking of in that one that goes... And that's very hard to play on the piano, that... And the orchestra goes, if I was having a bad night when I was performing this, I could just fake that out and put a glissando in. When in doubt, gliss. Well, we're having a good fun kicking around what makes Ravel's music special. I'm Virginia Eskin, and if you have any comments on our program, if you like Ravel or whatever, write to us. The address is a note to you, care of WGBH Radio. 125 Western Avenue, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. And the email address is a note to you at wgbh.org. A note to you is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. Ravel felt that he really should participate in World War One. I think that was true of almost everybody. And World War One was raging all around. And so he enlisted, of all things, as a private soldier in the infantry. And they assigned him to drive a lorry. Apparently the truck was often in disrepair. So it's kind of dubious, actually, how much battlefront he saw. But he saw enough to be horrified. And there are pictures of him in crazy-looking uniforms. He looks like de Gaulle, a very short de Gaulle, albeit. And then there's another photograph of him in a big goatskin coat, and he looks like a creature out of some ballet, actually. Like, he looks like a fawn who's grown too much fur. But he wanted to do the right thing, and then he was honorably discharged. And this next piece I want you to hear is very unusual. I remember coming to know about it years ago because it's for five hands. And I don't think there's any other piece in the literature written for five hands. It's for two people with two hands, and then a third person is allowed to stand and poke in these sort of notes like birds at the very top. And it's called Frontispiece. And it's written after a poem by a man named Duvadar. And it's supposed to be a kind of a philosophical look at the aftermath of the wartime experience. And it comes from 1919. And they liken it to Stravinsky. And I think the reason they do is because at the very end, there are these hideously low and loud chords. It starts off, it's for five hands, and it's also in 5/8. And since I don't have five hands, I barely have two, I can't keep playing it. But I just wanted you, we're going to play a recording of it. I wanted you just to hear the beginning of it. But it has a sort of hypnotic effect because of that thing that you'll hear throughout this. And there's all sorts of stuff all around it. And the person on the bottom is going. That keeps on going, and that hand goes, and then the bird cheeping goes on, and then at the very end, this is sort of the gruesome part. And it builds up to a huge fortissimo, and then the very last chord goes out like a whimper. Here it is, Frontispiece, and it's played by three people, Paul Jacobs, Gilbert Kalish, and then Teresa Stern is the little bird on the top. Isn't that an odd little thing? That was sort of a rare piece written by Ravel for five hands, composed in about 1918. And from there on, he sticks to his guns and he's writing more and more orchestral music. He's going to branch out and eventually write the piano concerto for the left hand and the regular piano concerto, the one that's played so much in G major. And we'll listen to that in a little bit. Let's go back to the Spanish motif. And here's a famous piece, Rapsodie Espagnole by Ravel. And there are several movements. We're going to listen to two, Malagueña, which just means peace from Malaga, the beautiful seaport town in Spain. And the other one is Habanera. And I guess the most famous thing about a habanera is its rhythm. It's kind of like a tango. You know, a tango goes, and a habanera is much slower. It's the most famous one. And you'll hear that in the second piece. Here are two movements from Rapsodie Espagnole.
Thank you.
Those were two movements from Rapsodie Espagnole by Ravel, Malagueña and Habanera. And the Habanera is a sailor's song. When the Spanish sailors were in Havana, they would bring a little bit of their Spanish music, and it has those repeated notes that Ravel loves. The rhythm on the bottom. And then you could hear all those wonderful castanets and snare drums, and those, of course, contribute to the Spanish flavor. You wouldn't put those in a piece by Beethoven. It would sound perfectly disgusting. That was played by the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra, Jesus Lopez Cobos conducting. Now we're going to go to a very unusual piece by Ravel. It's not played very much. I don't know why. I'm playing it a couple times coming up this spring with different violinists, and they were amazed that I knew it. And I said, oh yeah, I love that piece. And it's got a very cute second movement, because what happens, it begins very invitingly, much in the same way that that first string quartet that we listened to, you know, it sort of ambled in. Starts off in G major, and then all of a sudden he's in the land of B flat. So it's very pleasing, and it ambles along, and again, it has a lot of these sort of Spanishy little clicking notes, and he mixes that up with these wonderful passages where go. Almost like he's making fun of us. He's playing sort of little bits and pieces of all kinds of things, like a basket full of colored ribbons. The first movement doesn't really go anywhere. It just sort of, it's like a pleasant walk. And then he gets to the second movement, and the violinist usually takes his instrument and puts it down and plays it just like a guitar, because when you do that, you get a different feel, and you're gonna, the violin is gonna play these chords. And the piano comes in. It's a wonderful piece. It has a lot of sort of Stefan Grappelli kind of smarminess. It's so different than the first movement. The other thing that I wanted to mention is that when Ravel writes these kinds of they're like a big arabesque, you know, where a chord goes into an arpeggio like that, or something. It's odd on a piano. Where he got that idea is, of course, from the guitar, because the guitar has six strings, and you can make that kind of wonderful arpeggiation very easily. Anyway, let's listen to the second movement, where the violin is turned into a little guitar. Here it is.
Thank you.
That was the second movement of Ravel's Violin Sonata. And it's pretty bluesy, don't you think? It was played by Régis Pasquier and Brigitte Angeret. And I love the way that sounds. And that's going to move nicely now, because when Ravel came to New York, he certainly was intrigued by jazz. And he did get to meet George Gershwin. And we know that Gershwin wanted to study with him. But it turns out that Gershwin was making tons of money. And Ravel was supposed to have said, I should study with you. I should study how to write music that makes so much money. And in the end, Gershwin didn't live long enough to take lessons from Ravel, unfortunately. But back in around 1908, when he composed the great Gaspard de la Nuit suite, he's already flirting with Gershwin-esque kind of tonalities. And this is the middle movement, Le Gibet, which is the corpse hanging in the wind. And these are the bells of the town square. And they repeat like an ostinato.
Thank you.
goes on, and I'm going to skip over to the end. I just wanted you to hear how sexy those chords can be, and it's sort of hard because your hand is spread out. You got to play all those chords and keep those B flats. Even if you didn't know it was a corpse hanging on a rope, it has a very macabre sort of sound. It's unlike the fast-moving, whirling dervish music that Ravel usually writes. And that's why we love it. Le Gibet, the middle movement from his great Gaspard de la Nuit suite. Well, let's listen to two short examples from his only piano concerto for two hands. And I think it's a very odd beginning. There's a pistol crack at the beginning of the piece, and then he ends the last movement with a big kick in the rear with a bass drum. And if that isn't being wry, I don't know what else is. Nobody had ever thought to do that in music. Here it is, the beginning of the piano concerto, and then we'll skip very quickly to the end of the piano concerto. And there's some of that kind of habanero flavor, too, that Ravel likes to put into everything. And now we're going to go to the final movement of the piano concerto, because it begins and ends in a pretty bizarre way, too. So you have the notion that he's not just going to amble nicely into these pieces. He's going to try to hit you on the head with the pistol crack. I've been in audiences and people sort of thought somebody was assassinated in the audience when they hear that, because it's a little alarming. The pianist there was Alicia de la Rocha, and she was accompanied by Leonard Slatkin with the St. Louis Symphony. And I hope you've enjoyed our short incursion into the life of Maurice Ravel. He really is worth many looks, and he's written charming music. Oh, so many beautiful things, the Mother Goose Suite, and all the sort of homages to Couperin and Haydn. He loved classical style. I wish I'd met him. He sounds like an interesting man. This beautiful house that he lived in that was so teeny tiny and elegant. You could go there, like in Alice in Wonderland, have a cup of tea. So, our engineer today has been Antonio Oliart Ross, who's an expert on things Spanish. Our producer is Alan McClellan, and I'm Virginia Eskin. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. It's produced by Northeastern University in cooperation with WGBH Radio, Boston. Thank you.